The new Volvo V40 or V40 as we say in Germany, the facelift, is today in Autogefühl, your number one resource for in-depth car reviews and your number one community to discuss cars with Thomas. We're going to explain all the details in general about this car on exterior, interior and the driving experience, and of course also introduce all of the changes that come here with a recent facelift. One detail you can already see right now, it now features the Source Hammer headlights. More about that now in Autogefühl in full HD, full screen and full length. Let's go. This car proves that you can already get a great Volvo design with a basic Volvo or the smallest Volvo that is available. And the V40 now features in the facelift, starting with the momentum trim level. Those headlights here called Thor's Hammer, taken over from the XC90 or also from the S90 now, the new Volvo signature, you know, from the god Thor, who used his hammer sometimes when he was angry. And so this signature here with the lights, and it also comes with an option full LED light. Then there's still a little bit of a difference between the LED lamps that come with momentum middle trim level and here with the inscription we have, because here they also have this dynamic following LED lights, so you can really step up the game step by step. Basis, kinetic, momentum, inscription, or you can also pick an R design for the momentum or kinetic. This here, as I said, inscription trim level, you can see it also with a little bit stronger lower bumper, very elegant design also with the front grille. Here the sensors are hidden behind that one, but still a good solution. So overall a very tech and clean design definitely. 4.37 meters or 14.3 feet is the total length of this compact vehicle, and you can see it also has a sporty outline in the side profile. Here in the inscription trim level we got a lot of more designs and also optional 18-inch rims. Here in the, my favorite B color scheme, really looks nice with a, you know, silver and black contrast. And this color is also very special. It's called muscle blue, not like this muscle, but more the muscle, you know, at the beach. Muschel would be in German. And so it orients, you know, on the beach or sea kind of style. And I think it's really special in combination to those rims. So overall, a dream setup for this V40 definitely. The rear is also special with those curved taillights that already are visible in the side profile. And you can also see in the rear that you rather have a design focus with those lines we have here than a most space on the inside focus, so you have to be sure about that. But overall, again, also with the black contrast here, a very sensual design. And if you compare it to the very new Volvo models, I think this one still here holds its own beauty. Of course, price-wise, well, it's around in the region than the other compact premium competitors, for example, the BMW 1 Series, Audi A3 or the Mercedes A-Class. Starts at about 23,000 euros in Germany and then can easily go up way higher. And if you pick the biggest engines or highest trim level, around 40,000, this very test vehicle with all of the options it has, you will soon also see it on the interior, can also reach 50,000 euros list price. Your beta dealer better gets a good offer for you then. This is the key here. You can open it also with the keyless entry.
just put your hands there. Side mirrors flip out, nice. Then the door handles are really very solid. I like that. Also the door closing sound. And then Volvo is using a very interesting material already here at the upside of the doors from the inside, and also on the dashboard later on you will see. This is, I mean, artificial material, but it has this very neat structure and therefore it looks really high class. This is the inscription trim level on the inside, which I would not recommend. It looks very beautiful, also with this inscription cover here in silver. But with inscription, you always get animal skin seats. And with the Volvo V40 facelift, you get new cloth designs, and I would really be looking forward to see them. You get them in a basis trim level, kinetic or momentum, that's the middle trim level, then you still get cloth. Inscription only with animal skin, and our design is part animal skin, part cloth, part animal skin. The design, however, itself, Swedish design still, and even if it is not belonging to the new Volvo design scheme, I think it's still very beautiful. Also, look at this two color steering wheel, so great design ideas. Just pick other surfaces. Also, that they have this bright interior looks very nice, and then the dashboard is still black, and that's very important to have less reflections. Then let's get inside, and the seats are, as we know from Volvo, no matter which seats you pick, they are always very comfortable, and they seem to be especially suitable for me. I'm not sure if it's just me or if it's in general. Give me your feedback in the comments below if the Volvo seats always suit your body as well. So I feel perfectly comfortable also in the smallest Volvo here in the compact segment. However, the package, so what space we have on the inside, is not the best. So especially with this panoramic roof, there's not too much space above my head. Also, when you're thinking about here, connection from A to B pillar, not too much space. I'm 1.86 meters or 6'1" for all our non-subscribers, the information. Then this seat here in the inscription trim level is full electronic control, front to all of the sides. And you can also memorize your position. So like you see it holding the two, then it would be another, I'm not sure which driver this should be, maybe King Kong. But I've memorized this, my spot on one, then I just hold the one. If you share driving this car, then it's a really practical solution. And how to memorize it? I just hold the M and the one button at the same time. And if the ignition would be turned on, do it right now, ignition turn on first. Then hold, that is because the door is open, always those annoying warning sounds. Holding M and 1 at the same time. This doo-doo you maybe just heard. Then says setting stored to memory button 1. And now I turn it off again. You don't have this beeping sound. And the cockpit overview. The key is basically keyless. You can also just start a car here. If you want to have it stored, you can put it here. But you don't have to. You maybe know if you don't have the keyless option, then you have to put the key there. So it depends on. In general, Scandinavian design, keeping it simplistic. Again, here, this great surface we have here. So I don't need any animal skin on the dashboard. When we have such an interesting surface here, looks really premium, no question. Also with those contrasts, how the instruments are framed, even though the screen is, as it's not the newest Volvo, still from 2012, screen is relatively small, but the resolution in general is okay. Then we got matte wood. I love that. Favorite also when you touch it, also in the sound it makes and the haptical feeling, really great. This classic analog style instrument, let's take it that way, because you see a lot of buttons and stuff. Yeah, I mean, it's still quite okay, and it's also framed quite well. It looks a little bit overwhelming, but we're going to take a detailed look at that very soon, because a lot of buttons still make perfectly sense also with the wind control. Soon more details about that. Then the steering wheel set, great two color scheme. So from a visual part, that is really great. Cruise control here, sound there, also with shifting pedals that are optionally available or automatically come with the automatic if you have it in the D4 diesel. glove box slides down smoothly and a lot of space on the inside. Really like it. And if you want to put a SIM card, you can put it right here, and then you also have an internet connection. That SIM card would be stored right there. More storage right here, beverage holders. They also hold here flexible 12 volt power supply. Below the armrest, see, reasonable quality. USB port, another 12 volt power supply, and good space. And the space on the inside of the doors, a little bit hidden. You have to squeeze stuff in there. And the same accounts a little bit for here, for the zombie space, so-called zombie spaces. I was calling it like, you have to discover that first, that you really see that something possible here. And again, from this perspective, we also see this swinging design structure of the Scandinavian design. Just love it. The rear mirror has no black frame. That's a beautiful design element. Looks really seamless. Then new with the facelift is the SOS button and the Volvo on-call system for additional services. It will be introduced with every car in, I think, 1 or 2 years. That will be mandatory, but now the manufacturers are already integrating it, that in case of emergency, it either goes off automatically, or if you see an emergency situation, you can press it and then there's a phone call automatically done. Then the panoramic roof is available. That's also equipped here. And sometimes when you think about, when you open it, hey, why doesn't it work? Yeah, it's the other way around, because it starts right here. So that way is open, and this way is then to close it. And there you see it, big panoramic roof, lets a lot of light into the interior. It's a little bit darkened, that not too much sun is coming in, that doesn't get too hot. And then of course, the full shade when you want to have it rather cool here in the car. And well, it takes some time, but I think it's nice to have it, although you cannot open it. That's of course the downside then of this system. Instruments, and I've turned on the engine and everything is available. You see the average consumption in the lower left, that can go even more down. We'll talk about that one later. Fuel on the left as well. And then in the middle part also, you see the digital display, that's maybe doors open, and then seams. There's the performance view with big RPM. You can also pick the eco view, the green, and elegance view. Like this, so it's nice that you can switch the layouts of this digital instruments. And well, everyone's talking about digital instrument those days. Volvo has already introduced them 2012, so quite a long time, you know. And I think overall it does a good job. You don't miss the analog instruments for real. And when you turn off everything, see it like this. When I open the door, it should also dissolve totally. Let's see. Yeah, takes some time until it dissolves, but you can see this is the proof that our digital, that stuff is changing in the middle part. Middle console here, the gear shifting lever has a good grip, and also easy system. Just pull the button behind it here and then just put it down to D mode, or N and D goes the switch without pulling the button. And the R mode then again for reverse, putting the button. And you can also go to S when you want to shift manual like this up and down. So, and then I'll turn on the engine. That's a little bit more silent right here. AC can be put on and off right here. This is here for the strength of the vents. Seat heating can be controlled here. Right side for the temperature. I press this button to switch right or left temperature. And also seat heating right here, that is possible. Sound right here, and there's a sound also created by the knobs. I don't like it that much. Our cameraman does like it, so it's personal preference. Sound settings, you can always reach by that. And then those buttons here, well, what are they still for? When you want to type in a telephone number, you know, like 0800 Autogefühl, for example. I haven't tried calling a number, but the guy will be maybe a little bit annoyed if this number exists. You can easily access that one and with the telephone. That is one way, for example. And those buttons have also a function in the GPS. I will soon show you that, because this one here, like those, they work to, you know, to control the GPS to move inside the map. I will soon show you that up in the screen. And this visualization is still nice, that you can easily change where the vents should be coming from. So it is still justified to have those buttons, and some really prefer to have it still. Then with the recent facelift, also the Clean Zone technology has been introduced right here. And Clean Zone is available optionally, and that means that the air is filtered or cleaned even better. That might be very relevant for driving in polluted cities, for example. Then the infotainment screen is still, as I said, rather small, but it does the job. You can control it with the basic knob I showed you in the lower part by turning the knob right and left and pressing the OK or back button. And you can just cruise around some systems camera, for example. See when the car is turned on, then it should be available. Rear view camera right there. It's also activated when you put in reverse gear. The resolution is not the most modern one, but it does the job. Rear view zoom. That is the rear view camera, and with a little bit of zoom in that you can really closely approach the rear end of the car. But I'll stick to that one here. Then internet would also be available if you have a SIM card, but not sure if that's that useful if you have to type in internet address right here, because if you type in an address here, it, you know, see it takes ages, like www.autogefuel.com or whatever. You know, I'm not really sure how useful that is overall. Then let's go back. My car phone connection via Bluetooth is available. Then you can stream your music or also use your standard phone stuff, media USB, for example, radio, and one look at the GPS, which is still very small, basically, but it does the job as well, zooming in with the button. And then you remember the phone numbers. And when you press the phone numbers, you can also see it here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. And press those buttons each, like I'm pressing 2 now or 3, then you can move inside the map, and when you press the 5, the middle number, for 2 times, then it hops back to the central point. So still a good use, as it's no touch screen. So what's left here in the rear? First of all, also a nice design still. Also look here how they've designed the solid door handles with metal, also with this spang here. Nice detail. Some storage space here for the rear passengers. You wouldn't expect it. Flipping the seats is only possible from here. And then there are 2 buttons. First of all, this one here is just to flip the headrest, like this. This one here is to flip the whole seat, and then there's an indicator that it's unlocked for security reasons. If you have it like this, maybe, and then it's not really properly locked, then you really see that it's unlocked. And then it works like this, and it goes for an even loading space to the trunk. We will soon show you that as well. You cannot unlock them from the trunk area, so you have to do it from here. And then when I get inside, let's check the space. This is not, you know, the special discipline of the V40. Knee space-wise, you see, as I would be driving with as a tall driver, that's still okay for a compact car, comparable to other competitors. But then headspace-wise, especially with the panoramic roof, I hit my head here at the ceiling, so I cannot really sit upright here. That's it. So I'm not sure. It might be better when you don't pack the panoramic roof. So, but overall, not the best result here. But if you would be a little bit smaller, then in general, the seating comfort is very good here. What else I can show you is this middle part. And then slide down this armrest for the rear passengers. And very funny, she sees this strap here, the black strap here, pulling it. Then you can have some beverage holders right here. Funny system, definitely. Open, close, open, close. I'm sure a lot of children will play around with that one. Might be a little bit annoying for the drivers then. And the trunk or the boot. Nice that we also have this bright cover. I just love the bright color style of the interior. You can of course also remove that one. You just have to pull it like this. And then I've also, see, flipped one of the sides that you can see how you can load through. In general, well, there's not too much space here in the trunk, you have to admit. Mediocre. In general, 12-volt power supply is here again in the trunk. And they've made the cover that it matches the rear of the seats. You can also remove that one. That is possible. And if you hold that one here up, then there's some more space below that. And it's a very interesting system because you can also flip this part here and then, for example, split the trunk area if you want to put some shorter things in there. And below that one here, even then, there could be optional replacement tire. Here it's the tire repair kit. Engines. This is a diesel engine here. It starts with a D2, 120 horsepower, D3, 150 horsepower, or here the D4 with 190 horsepower. 7.2 seconds from 0 to 100 kilometers an hour or 0 to 60 miles an hour. And then about petrol, T2, 122 horsepower, T3, 152 horsepower, T4, 190 horsepower, or T5, 245 horsepower. And what is basically to say about those engines? Well, they are always 2 liters of displacement and always 4 cylinders. You know, Volvo is going all the way only with 4 cylinders anymore, which is, well, not such a bad decision. I mean, why not? So stuff gets collected here quite easily. So they say, you know, we are just fine with 4 cylinders. If you want to have even more horsepower, there's this Polestar tuning, for example, for the T5 and here the D4. Then you get about 10 horsepower more for about 1,000 euros. Doesn't really make sense. Well, it boosts the torque a little bit more, and people who have built it in say, I do feel the difference. And then what about shifting, 6-speed manual or 8-speed automatic gearbox? And the 8-speed automatic gearbox that we have in here is really very recommendable, so you should definitely go for that. All-wheel drive we don't have here, it's always in the front wheel drive, but it's still okay. Even if you have the powerful engines, you don't have too much wheel spin in the front. And last but not least, what's the most important thing about the Volvo? The safety stuff. And here, for example, also, or with every Volvo, the autonomous emergency brake is inbuilt. And they say we can promise that until a speed of 15 kilometers an hour, accidents where you would rush on the car in front of you can be, you know, won't happen then. And about 50 kilometers an hour, then you say, okay, at least we can reduce the impact. And then optional to this basic feature, you can also get this feature where also pedestrians and cyclists are also realized by the system. That is also a recommendable option to go to. And now to the driving part. We were just having a laugh because Michel, my cameraman, complained about driving the F-Type SVR last time and he was having a hard time with the ears, you know, like from the sound. Those are some discussions on Autogefühl between reporter and cameraman. But sound won't be a big issue here today. Well, at least not a too loud sound. But we can tell you something about this diesel engine here, the D4 in the Volvo V40. 190 horsepower, 7.2 seconds from 0 to 100 kilometers or 0 to 60 miles an hour. Inscription terminal on the inside, as we've told you earlier. And well, let's start with the diesel because, especially when standing still and when starting the engine, it is relatively loud and has this typical diesel nailing, as you would call it. So doesn't have the most refined sound. However, when I'm driving now about 50 kilometers an hour and there's a higher gear, then the engine also becomes more silently, also in comparison to what we have on the outside. We also have a blind spot assistance system, by the way. You will soon see it also here on the left side when this light here is turning red. So we'll also talk about assistance systems. We'll tell you something about driving in the city, autobahn, and also in the countryside. In general, this diesel here is very powerful. It's the most powerful one you can get. Optionally, you can also get the Polestar tuning, 10 horsepower more, even more newton meters of torque. Does it really pay off to pay this 1,000 extra? I'm not really sure. Power-wise, you'll be very satisfied with this diesel engine here, feeling more silent and more refined than the petrol engines are the better choice. The steering is not that light, so it depends, of course, a little bit on the speed. But if you, you know, have to turn the car around, you have to work a little bit with that. In general, also while driving, I really like to have this two-color steering wheel. That makes a very good impression, also premium feeling while driving the car. Also, nice sound from the turning indicators. Sometimes we have this, there's a very weird sound from the turning indicators. That's not the case here. Stop-start function, activating here as well. And I've activated the performance mode into the screen here in the front, as I've shown you earlier with the interior. So you always pick your preferred mode then. This diesel, by the way, from the truck next to us. This is not the diesel here. You will soon hear when it gets activated again. As for the visibility to the rear, we have this almost frameless mirror, and still okay, even though if the rear window is not that huge. To the sides, well, the side profile raises a little bit. But overall, you have a good overview to all of the sides. And the car also, when you drive it, it feels very compact, so it doesn't feel huge at all. And that's also for the handling. So it feels really like almost like a small, versatile car. And that's definitely a big contrast to the other, for example, also very new Volvos you can get in the upper segments here. And to remember, it will take some time still until they refresh the smaller models here with the V40, as they're also not that important for the Chinese and the US market. That's also the main reason for that. So we are slowly approaching the autobahn. Let's do some lane change again to show you the steering. Feels rather neutral, so you know, not moving towards one or other direction very extremely. So last red traffic light, there it goes green already for the motorway, and then we can also tell you something about the performance. You know, in the mid speed regions, what about 30 to, let's say, whatever, 70, let's go now. That's it. That was like 3275. You heard that the diesel engine sounds quite well still when the RPMs are turned up. So it's really interesting that in the normal mode, when it's just running on neutral, it doesn't sound that well, but sounds better when it's going at higher RPMs. Very interesting. The sound insulation so far, can't moan about that. I mean, that's basically in all Volvos that we're basically satisfied with the sound insulation. If I move on to the right side and someone might be overtaking me from the left now, then watch at this BLIS, the blind spot information system there. It flickers the red light. That means someone is coming from behind. Will be overtaking again on the motorway, probably. So now we can accelerate as well, 70 to 100. Let's see what that brings us. And that's it, yeah, already. So really good performance from this D4 diesel. You won't lack any power, also not at higher speeds. So let's see, you have to move away, police.
glad they didn't mean us. I did nothing wrong, so I was quite certain they didn't mean us. But in this case, it was also allowed, like, you know, to increase the speed more than I would be allowed for once, to make free way for the police, you know, but whoever they want to catch, you know, and it might be you calling them, and then you also want them to reach the destination as fast as possible. But it's always still a strange feeling when police are appearing behind you. You always think, oh, did I do something wrong? Did I do something wrong? But in this case, we didn't. Adaptive cruise control, really premium with Volvo. Just setting it here on the left side of the steering wheel to 100, and then distance is kept and also reduced until 0 km/h. And this is a system I basically trust the most in the automotive industry. And then the Mercedes system is also very good. The very new Audi systems as well. Here, for example, car got in my lane. There's no, you know, sudden brake or something like that. You know, the speed is reduced in front of me, and also my speed is reduced very smoothly. And then I also again the acceleration, so that's very, very flawlessly. I really like it when those automatic cruise controls work in such a smooth way. That's really great, and they have definitely achieved that. It has been refined over the years. Let's go off the motorway, maybe also here a little faster. See how the brakes work. Overall, the car gives you a really good and, let's say, neutral feeling, and we also move in a region where you cannot exactly say that this is a very sporty, compact car, but it's also not that you say this is just set on comfort and a very, very soft ride. They're really like way in the middle, you know? You have a lot of comfort and it's still sporty enough. So I think they have a good neutral setup that everyone will be basically satisfied with the car. Except you have, you know, a very, very sporty approach to something like that, but then it's truly not the best choice. Maybe then with the R design, something like that. But in general, I think they've really found a good setup with this car, suspension wise. So you always feel basically comfortable, and that is also one of the secrets of this car. You're buying the smallest Volvo, but basically get all of the stuff you can basically get in a Volvo and the basic premium feeling in a Volvo. And well, this car here, as I've mentioned it earlier, is really expensive, this very vehicle. But in general, the V40 can also be bought way cheaper then, and I would also recommend that. And then you can really get this premium Volvo feeling also at a reasonable price. You might have seen that we have this fuel monitor set up here, and I'm quite surprised about the fuel consumption of this engine, because it really comes close to the officially stated one. Just for our small trip here, the consumption says, whoa, it even jumped to 4.9 liters now. Although we did some acceleration tests, that's really astonishing. And then we have also on this monitor here a longer trip. So a 2-hour trip with 100 kilometers, so it was right before then. That scored even below 6 liters on 100 kilometers. So overall, I mean, we don't have that quite often, that we say the fuel consumption is really okay, but I mean, with something about 5 liters, maybe something between 5 and 6, that's really okay. I mean, it's a compact car and it's a diesel, but still, there's a lot of equipment in here, and the car is already about, I think, 1,600 kilograms of the empty weight. That is really okay. Then some more slalom test here. You see, it's not the most direct steering, but it's a reasonable approach. And you could say it's a little bit of a sporty feeling. So no matter if you want to drive sporty or comfortable, you can do that at the same time. And you don't always need an adaptive suspension. That's always an extra then as well. And with the suspension we got mounted here, that's perfectly fine, definitely. So maybe some downsides, I don't know. Maybe, well,
there's not too much space here on the inside. You realize it when driving as well. Also, you have the feeling that the front screen is coming very close to you. But other than that, you know, there's hardly anything to moan with this. It's still here, although it's not the newest car, a very good package. And the driving itself didn't really change that much with the facelift. Maybe with that, you know, better vision than at night with the new headlamps, that could play an effect, but we don't have the chance to drive the car at night here right now. And we also have this clean zone air vents we've mentioned earlier. Does it feel like we would have better air here in here than normal? We got the AC on as it's quite hot today, but maybe. I don't know if you really realized it, then the difference with the clean zone air, at least not if you are in a generally in an area where it's not that polluted. If you live in a rural area where it's very polluted, then you might notice the difference. I don't know, but here we got a relatively clean zone outside here as well, so I'm not sure if we need the clean zone on the inside, but always good to have it as well. So that's it from driving. And now our conclusion, Volvo V40 facelift. Well, there haven't been drastic changes, but those slight refinements are very pleasing, like the Thor's hammers light in the front, or also some of the tweaks in the interior. I think it's perfectly fine, because even though this car is initially from 2012, it is basically still up to date in a lot of aspects. And here also, with the smallest Volvo, you basically get everything you expect from a Volvo. Well, maybe not the past times where you had too lot of space on the interior. That's kind of gone now, so there's not too much space on the interior. That's maybe the only downside. But everything else, design focus, exterior and interior, the refinement in the build quality, and also the driving comfort, especially with the seat form, you already get that here in the V40. And if you stick with the momentum trim level, with the middle trim level, that would be my tip for you, then the price is also quite okay still. If you pick here with everything optional inscription trim level, then the car really gets too expensive, and you can easily also get the bigger car, for example. But if you remain, for example, with the momentum trim level, you already get the headlights in the new beautiful form and still have already a lot of comfort on the interior. I would like to see your comments now on the exterior, interior and the driving in general about the V40, and of course also about this very facelift. You wanted to see this video here, and you know, it's our pleasure always to fulfill as much wishes as possible, and in this case we could do it again. So you asked for this facelift video, and we delivered you that on Autogefühl, and I'm sure we'll see each other at our next episode.